travel down to the sea in ships means Frankie and Jeff Clarkson, who didn't intend to sail around the world but found themselves doing just that. They're 64 and 62 respectively, quite an age to cover about 40,000 miles in a small boat. But you mentioned sailing, you've talked about the Clarksons, and here they are, Frankie and Jeff. Fantastic trip you did. Marvellous. How did you set out on it, Frankie? What prompted you to take that 40,000 mile trip?
We wanted to go. We didn't go 40,000 miles at first. We were just going to Seattle to visit relatives. We'd always wanted to for years and years. 58, we decided. We told them we went on the Queen Mary, that we were going to one day cross the Atlantic in our own boat. And suddenly the opportunity was there. We were in coming up to 60. Why not go? It would have been too late otherwise.
So you had no thoughts about, oh dear, retirement?
Good Lord,
what
no.
are we going to do with ourselves?
No.
You
nothing
always
like
know.
That. I didn't think about retirement. It just is.
Mm. Tell me how you set out. I mean, you must have been experienced sailors, were you, to undertake a journey like this, Jeff?
We learned how to sail. Unusual in our case, because Frankie was has the Admiral into ancestry and persuaded me to go to sea. This is a reversal of normal pattern in this country. So she couldn't sail either, so I suggested she went to a sailing school. She went to a sailing school, and I had to go to a sailing school. And I had various sessions with a retired naval commander in Torquay, learning coastal navigation and finishing up with Celestial and finding a way across the oceans. And as Frankie said, as our main desire was to sail across the Pacific to see relatives in Seattle and Vancouver, that limit of our range. We saw our relatives in Seattle, and I was then going to hike the boat across the Rockies, drop her in the Great Lakes, and bring her back the following year. But administrative troubles with bringing a boat ashore, they wouldn't let me go with it. So Sunbright's Park suggested, why don't you float the boat home the other way? So that's what we did. And so 4 years later, we've arrived back in England again. Mm. Accidental circumnavigation of the world.
Did you feel it was a tremendously adventurous thing to do when you set out there? Did you have your qualms about it?
Really? It was a bit like when you first go to school. You want to go but keep looking back. That was the first ocean, you know, the Atlantic. Mm. But after that, no. It was so beautiful.
What did you enjoy most about the trip?
Oh, Alaska.
Why?
Well, it's so... it's a frontier. And do you cut your own trees? If you want a piece of wood, you cut a tree down. You fish for salmon, or they give you salmon. It was just so free. Mm. We could have got lost up there. And it was so beautiful, of course. Mm.
But you did have problems. I mean, did you ever panic? You nearly starved once. Tell us about that.
Well, when we were in Panama, of course, you're in the American zone, and you're not allowed to shop there because it's military. So we went into Panama, which is a long way, and we didn't have an awful lot of money for taxis and things like that. And it's a very, very long, hot walk. And we went around the various supermarkets, and all the tins, most of the tins, are in English and Spanish, but they didn't like the Americans then, so they had them all turned around with a foreign language outside. So I bought various wrong things, like porridge, which was a drink, and yeast, which wasn't brewer baking yeast at all. And then we couldn't find any meat.
And that was the problem?
That was the problem.
Mm.
Now, we allowed ourselves 90 days to do the trip. We're expecting to do 120. We did it in 126 days. And I sailed with 90 meals short. So we ran out of food.
So
and
what,
we nearly
what did
ran
you
out
do?
Of water. Well, we got smaller and smaller. And you see...
I couldn't imagine.
And you see, you couldn't really sit all day waiting for two sardines and an ounce of rice. Mm. So you had to do something psychological with this. So we got, first of all, we started with big plates, then smaller plates, then saucepans, saucers. Mm. Then I gave names to all the meals, so it didn't matter what it was. The last one was memory of meat, and that kind of thing.
How did you occupy yourselves in those times?
Oh, we would never had time.
Never had time no. to think about not having time
no,
or
no.
having too much time.
It really, you get out, you see, it's shifts. We didn't have watches. We didn't have a self-steering device. And so you had to sail the boat. And we did 2 hours on, 2 hours off, from 4 in the afternoon until midnight.
Did you sleep then, in the 2 hours off?
Well, you tried to. No, not every two. 2 hours, from 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we would have our main meal of the day, you know, because we were related to the light and the dark. Then I would be on at 12 midnight until 4. Then Jeff would go on at 4 until 9, and he'd have breakfast in the middle. And then we'd start the day.
Did you ever get tired?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, very tired. And then I'd say, let's go home. And so we'd stop the boat and have a day in the boat, and that was going home.
But you had that time when you nearly starved.
Yes.
I mean, did you ever think that you might die?
We didn't think about it, did we?
Well, some guy in the States asks us what you'd do if you faced death. We didn't think about it. You don't. Just go on, don't you? I hope everybody just goes on, and when you drop, you drop. Don't think about it. You can't plan for it. You're here to stay as long as you can. Enjoy it. Keep fit. Live as long as you can. Be vital. We love it.
You're vital enough, you two.
Yes, well,
listen, tell me about your fishing. Did you do a lot of fishing to get the fish from the sea?
We learned fishing after we starved. We had to, so that's helpful. And then we were given lures, and we caught a lot of big fish. Flying fish used to fly on deck. Every ocean yacht has flying fish on its deck in morning for breakfast. It's a spin-off. But talk about what we did. From England to Australia, we had no self-steerer. So we did this watch and watch about. And after New Zealand, a guy took great pity on us and said, you've been this far without a self-steerer. And he fitted one up for us. Cost about $2. And
so
the rest
after
of the journey, it was a revelation.
Like another member of the crew?
Yes. A new life opened up before us.
You did a lot of trading with people, didn't you? They were very kind to you around the place.
Yes. To get around the world, in some countries, money's no use to you because they only barter. So I had copper nails for boat repairs, and they wanted copper nails, so exchanged those for pamplemousse and bananas. We had a cockpit full of fresh fruit in one island. Fantastic life.
I said, do you think it would be a good thing if barter came in here now that money is becoming no use to us?
It's already here, far as
we're concerned. Well, I think it is terribly important for the older age group. We've got these skills, which are not so much cash around.
Well, we go and collect our own logs now. Jeff saws them up and we carry them about 2 miles.
And distribute them amongst our brother and ourselves. I agree with you. Self-help. I help you, you help me.
You have this to offer, no money.
Yes. We meet afterwards and plan it.
But did you ever run out of money? I mean, did you ever work, Frankie, when you were away?
I did two jobs. One as a cleaning lady in a motel, which was great fun, for about 6 weeks. But the real one was in Auckland, where I was a tea lady with TV2. It was just starting. That was hilarious because I was such a rotten tea lady. You know, they'd have these production meetings, and I'd go round and I'd say in their ear, do you want coffee or tea, sugar or cream? And then I'd forget who had what.
So that was one job you did?
Yes, two jobs I did, cleaning lady and...
I was just going to ask whether she finds any deterioration in her memory as she gets older.
No, words, perhaps, occasionally. I can't remember the word I want. But no, I haven't yet.
You've made lots and lots of friends, as I said, around the place, haven't you?
Oh,
tell
us
about some of them.
Well,
Peter
Herbst, that was way up in Skagway, which is as far north as we could go in the boat. That was in Alaska. And he came down to the boat terribly excited. Of course, everybody was excited to see a sailboat up there. They don't go. And he came down terribly excited. He was 11 years old. And come up to a meal, he told us. Mother and father would be very pleased to see us. So up we went, of course, asking for a bath. Wherever we went, we said to people, could we please bath? And we found we weren't really expected. And so Peter rushed out to a supermarket or something and bought some food, which he cooked. And it was really rather embarrassing, and then he stole the venison from his mother's deep freeze to bring down.
Did people think you were very strange to be sailing around the world on
your
boat?
No. They didn't, did they, Jeff?
No. In that part of the world, there's very few yachties, as we were called. And because we were rare in that part of the world, we had marvellous hospitality. And coming back to your question of money, that did help us get round the world. It's unusual for us because of some of the privations which got published in the media there. People did ask us out for meals, baths, and in fact, even the docking at the marinas, they didn't charge us. Well, obviously, they had to help us out a bit because when we got there, we were like a goldfish bowl. People just looking through the potholes and see who these queer people are. And then crowds used to come down, and then we moored the boat underneath their local restaurant. So they come down and see us and wander off for coffee. So we helped their business, and they helped us and gave us free mooring and hospitality. Mm. That happened all around the world.
Now you've got a mailing list, I imagine, with all the friends that you send postcards. So you've kept in touch, haven't you?
Oh, yes, I have about 300 people I write regularly.
Really? Mm. That keeps you busy. Are you fully occupied now you're back? What are you doing?
I've got too much to do.
Have you?
Yes.
That's a nice, cheerful thought, Diana, isn't it? Because it is something people should think.
And I think that's what they do. I think there's people who say, I've never been so busy in my life until I retired. It's because they've moved onto a plane where they can feel free. They can feel free of not having to worry about what other people think about them. Mm. And where the human values take over. Don't you find that? I mean, you're not worrying about profits and losses and success or progress, but it's the human values.
Well, when we were in, not Grenada, Curaçao, which is in the Dutch Antilles, a young man came on board. He was stopping at a very lush hotel. He'd just finished college, and he thought this was absolutely marvellous.
Mm, yes.
And so he said to us, do you think your standard of living will be the same when you get home? We said, we don't think so. Mm. Does it matter?
Mm, mm. So generally your attitude to growing old is what, Joanna? You think people
what
should
we
feel?
Own or what people should feel?
Generally, I think, what people should feel.
Well, I think they would just, if they can live in the present moment, it's so easy, I think, for sad old people to live in the past, or for worried old people to dread the future. But if only one can learn to live in the present moment, which I know you two must have done throughout your voyage, I'm sure.
Mm. Well, yes. We're doing what you are doing, Joanna, now. You've done your book. We're still writing ours.
we look forward very much indeed to reading that. And thank you very much indeed, Frankie and Jeff Clarkson, for coming, and Joanna Scott Moncrief.